My castaway this week is a comedian. He made his name with a highly original comic creation, a Liverpool tart with a platinum hairdo and a fondness for drink and drugs. He developed this act in pubs and clubs, took it to the Edinburgh Festival, and then started getting his own shows on television. These days he's stepping out of drag more and more, but the Scouse slag with the acerbic tongue remains his tour de force. "I think people thought I was a one-trick pony," he says. "They thought Lily would soon wither and die, but she didn't." Yes, he's the man behind the makeup and the miniskirt of Lily Savage, Paul O'Grady. She is, I mean, an extraordinary creation, Paul. I mean, not least because, you know, before her, all drag acts were kind of slinky, like Shirley Bassey, weren't they?
They were also matronly and sexless. We had Hinge and Brackett, who were fantastic, but they were two very nice matrons. Dame Edna was a matron.
And the Les Dawson women.
That's right. Nobody was ever sexual. You know, there was never a drag. And Lily was. She was unashamed.
Yes.
In that she did. She turned tricks for money and all that business.
But I presume that's not least because of the nature of your physique. I mean, you could hardly be a kind of lumpy, strange-bosomed matron. You couldn't do an Ina Sharples act, could you?
Not really, no. So you bung it all on me and people always say, "Oh, you've got fabulous legs." I've got dreadful legs. I've got really... I want Will Carling's legs. But I've got these, my mother used to have legs like two woodbines hanging out the packet. I've got these two skinny legs. So, of course, you put dancers' tights on them and stilettos, they look fantastic. I mean, I was legs for Prissy Polly. They look fantastic. But in reality, I won't wear shorts in the summer.
What, as a man?
No, good God, no. Wild horses.
But Lily always wears the mini skirt.
Lily does always the skirt, yeah.
And the kind of courage boots, are they? Or are they kind of three-quarter socks? I never know, but something that stops
boots,
at the knee.
No, they're thigh-length boots and all, and everything's... I look sometimes in the mirror and think, I can't go out in public looking like this. I cannot go on television. I'm hardly dressed. You know, there's two tea bags and a nettle held together with a plastic butterfly or something and a tassel hanging off me, erogenous zones, and I can't go on television looking like
but
this.
But you do.
I think my mother must be turning in her grave.
But how do we explain, I mean, this is the great conundrum, is how do we explain that this Liverpool slag who turns tricks, as you say, is suddenly on mainstream television? I mean, blankety blank, aren't his bloomers? I mean, Terry Wogan, move over.
I know, God knows. I don't know what it was.
And now you're going to do the generation game?
Yeah, but that's not as Lily.
Oh, that's you.
That's me. That's
Paul O'Grady.
That's Paul O'Grady. It gets very confusing, you know, because I get phone calls for jobs. Can we have Lily? And I say, well, I'm not in a Lily mood, you know, and they say, please, oh, go on then. Or can we have you? It's like the two of us in the family work. It's peculiar. But I'm not schizo about it, though.
You're not.
She's very much
in
the bin
liner. You know exactly where she belongs.
Yeah,
in the cupboard.
In the cupboard. The wig goes on, you've got Lily. The wig comes off, you've got me.
Okay, well, we got you this morning.
Yeah, you got me
this
morning.
What's your first record?
My first record is Joseph Locke singing "I'll Take You Home Again, Kathleen," because that reminds me of my childhood. My dad was Irish and he loved all the old Irish songs. And this, if there was a family get-together, somebody invariably got up and sang "I'll Take You Home Again, Kathleen," and everybody'd sob into the whiskey. And I hear it now. It'd bring tears to a glass eye, this song. I love it.
I'll take you home again, Kathleen, across the ocean wide and wild, to where your heart has ever been, since first you were my blushing bride. And green, I will take you to your home, Kathleen.
Joseph Locke, and I'll Take You Home Again, Kathleen, and memories of Birkenhead in what, the 1950s, your childhood?
I was born 1955, so yeah, 19, say the early 60s. Mm.
And your mum and dad were Molly and Paddy.
Molly and Paddy.
She's Molly Savage. That's Molly Savage, get the Savage from.
Yeah, that's where Savage came
but
from.
But it obviously was, from what I read, a very female-dominated household, this.
It was, because all the men in the family were all in the Navy. And those days you went to sea for a couple of years.
What, sort of on cruise liners or something?
All Cunard merchant line, navy. Blue Funnel, all merchant navy. My Uncle Harold was a chef on the Queen Elizabeth. Mickey and John, oh, they were all stewards. All of these, they always used to come out with bush babies and monkeys and American comics. And I remember they brought this bush baby home once, and my Auntie Annie said, oh, isn't it lovely? Isn't it good? It sleeps. All it does is sleep. And they all went to bed. Of course, this thing's nocturnal. And she came down in the night and it wrecked the place, ripped the glasses off her face, tore the curtains down, and off it went to Chester Zoo, this bush baby.
That was your Auntie Annie.
That was
but
my Auntie
it was your
Annie.
Auntie Chrissy who was the character, wasn't it? Or were they all?
They were all characters, because they were all born in real extreme poverty in Birkenhead at the turn of the century. Real Angela Asher stuff, you know, real. Makes Frank McCourt look like, I don't know, the Ideal Home Exhibition. I had a letter from an old lady once saying, are you any relation to the Chrissy Savage I was in the war, in the army with?
Is this a letter to Lily?
A letter to Lily, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So you must look like your Aunt Chrissy.
But, oh, God.
Or Lily does.
Well, I don't think so. No, she was very, she's a very smart woman, immaculately dressed. You never saw her without her makeup. And she was a clippy on the buses. So it was the shirt and tie, beautifully pressed outfit, the slacks, the little hat, the fingerless gloves, a machine slung over her shoulder, you know, her badge. I mean, she was a talker, Birkenhead. She was witty and she had a great string of one-liners, and she's quite hard. She came across as quite hard-bitten, but she wasn't at all. She was daft as a brush.
There must be the seeds of Lily in there. You can hear it, can't you?
There's got to be. I look at, I think back to Auntie Chris now. I can see it on the bus, you know, and I think, yeah, there's a... I sort of say where Lily was germinated, really, Auntie Chris.
What about you as a little boy in all of this? I mean, you were the baby, weren't you? You were two older sisters. You were a bit of an accident.
I was the last kick of a dying horse. I was the result of a liaison in a bed and breakfast in the Isle of Man.
Between your mother and father.
Yeah, that's what I always used to get told this. So, you know.
Ooh. So were you indulged then? Were
I
you
spoiled. Sort of... Dreadful, I'll admit that, yeah. I was indulged with food because my mum and dad, were, I was born to older parents, and they couldn't afford to, you know, to give up work in the summer holidays. I go over to my dad's family in Ireland on a farm, which I loved. But I couldn't quite handle my Auntie Bridget would go out and wring a chicken's neck and then it'd be slung on the table for dinner. And while we were eating this thing, hens would be underneath the table, you know, picking...
You knew they were next.
Yeah. And eggs. I remember my Aunt Sabina saying, eat that duck egg, this huge smelly duck egg. So it put me off food completely. So they used to, because I was mad as on Popeye as a child, they used to have to put all food in a tin, pretending it was spinach.
And you squeezed the tin and the top popped off.
And I'd eat whatever it was then. And my sister said, oh, feel his muscles. So they were really, when I think back, there's none of this, you know, eat that. They really indulged me. They had great imagination. I thought, how can we get this child to eat? I'm just the same now about food. My idea of hell is being forced to sit in a restaurant. I hate it. So if I go, say, to the Ivy now, Silla always has to say, put his food in a can and we pretend it's spinach.
Take it home to Buster.
Yeah, we do the da-da-da-da-da-da.
Tell me about record number two.
Record number two is You Gotta Get a Gimmick, and it's from a musical called Gypsy. We didn't have burlesque in this country. We had variety and musical. But the Americans had burlesque with bawdy, brash, comedians, strippers. Or just, it must have been wonderful. In fact, if I could go back in time, I'd be a burlesque stripper. And this to me sums up the whole thing. You've got to get a gimmick.
You can pull all the stops out till they call the cops out. Grind your behind till you're banned. But you gotta get a gimmick if you wanna get a hand. You can sacrifice your sacro, working in the back row, bump in a dump till you're.
That's how burlesque was born.
So I and I and I but I do it with a horn.
You Gotta Get a Gimmick from Gypsy, sung by Linda Hart, Anna McNeely and Christine Ebersole. Let's go back to Birkenhead still, because I'm still interested. I mean, who were your heroes then, or what would you and the family watch on the television? You know, what turned you on then?
Ken Dodd, I loved as a kid. Frankie Howard, Alf Garnett. We were mad on Alf, although I wasn't allowed to watch Alf Garnett when, as a small child. You know, I was like, get him upstairs.
Language too strong.
Yeah. Dave Allen. My mother loved because all the religious gags she understood.
And do I imagine you a bit like the royal family, you know, sort of sitting around the telly? Or
far from it. No, my mother never sat down. She used to stand in the kitchen and eat. So she'd serve the food and we'd sit down and she stood in the kitchen and shouted, "Is that nice?" And we'd say, "That's lovely, thanks." So she never joined us for a meal, my mum. She was always on the hop.
But your mum and your dad were really, really in love, weren't they? That was the
I never
nice
saw
bit.
Them fight. Not once. Not once did I, and I can say that hand on heart, not even crosswords. And if my dad had gone off to St. Joseph's Social Club on a Sunday night and had a few scoops and he'd come in and my mother would be sat on the couch knitting, I'd be watching the Avengers and he'd go, "Oh, I'll take you home." And she'd go, "Oh my Christ, your dad's off." And it was with great affection she said that. And he'd throw his arm round her and kiss her and say, "I love you, my Molly." And he'd grab me and I'd die. And he'd say, "Here's my baby." I'd be saying, get off me, squirming. Just get away from me. Hated the pair of them. Get away from me.
But you loved it. You were happy. It was warm.
Oh, very, very.
Yeah. You know, are they both dead now?
They did. In fact, what happened was my mum had a serious heart attack. I was 17, she was taken into hospital, and the doctor said to me, "Father, oh, she's not going to last the night," and my dad was dead in the morning.
Dad was dead?
Yeah, he just collapsed on the spot, and the doctor said if I could put on a death certificate he's died of a broken heart, then I would.
And what about your mum?
She survived for another 12, 14 years.
What a terrible story.
Dreadful. I'll never forget it. I was stood next to him, he went down like a ton of bricks. He couldn't cope without my mother.
Tears for souvenirs are all you left me. Memories of a love you never met. I just can't believe you could forget. After all those happy hours we spent together. Tears have been my only consolation, but tears can't mend a broken heart, I must confess. Let's forgive and forget, turn our tears of regret once more to tears of happiness. Tears have been my only consolation, but tears can't mend a broken heart, I must confess. Let's forgive and forget, turn our tears of regret once more to tears of happiness. Let's forgive and forget, turn our tears of regret once more to tears of happiness.
A bright little boy, got lots of O levels, yeah. 5 A levels. Can this be true?
No.
Oh, right.
No.
You've been fibbing again, Paul.
No, I probably have. I've been fibbing to journalists. I've got 5 O levels. No, I've got 5 O levels, 3 A levels.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah, you have got
yeah,
3 A levels.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
But then you left. You didn't want to go on in your education anywhere at all. You left and you joined social services.
Well, to go to university wasn't an option. It was never, you know, nobody ever said, would you like to go to university? So I left and went straight into the civil service. My mother said, you know, we get you in a job with a good pension. This is 16.
But there was some link, for some reason, you wanted to do it because you thought it was going to be like the Avengers.
I did.
Avengers. I
did.
I mean, I don't get the link.
Well, I thought civil service, Ministry of Defence, the Avengers. I ended up working civil service, Steers House, Department of Health and Social Security.
You were going to be Patrick McNee,
this
though,
is
were
it.
You? With the
or Tara
the
King, one of the two, whatever you like, whatever you wanted, whatever mood I was in. And I did that for 2 years and I was lousy, absolutely lousy at the job.
And you cut and ran and you
cut
ran to Manila and you ended up in Gus's bar in Manila in the Far East. Now, give me the full description.
Well, I was living in Makati at the time in Manila, and there was a fabulous bar called Gus's, the Dutch Inn, just great atmosphere. And there was a little three-piece band in the corner. I used to a atrocious three-piece band who'd belt out various tunes, but one of them was very good on a harmonica, and towards the end of the night he used to play this haunting tune. And years later I was watching a film called Miss Sadie Thompson with Rita Hayworth, and she sang this song. I never knew there were lyrics to it, and I couldn't believe how the lyrics fitted and summed up to me when living in the Far East.
I'm getting the blue Pacific blue. The feeling you get from real bad news. I wanna hear bells, I wanna see trains. I get in this mood whenever it rains. I'm getting the blues. Alone in the dark and so sultry night. You'd think of the times you ain't done right. To add to the fact you're feeling so bad, the cry of the birds keeps driving you mad. Part of the blues. You lie awake and how you wish that it was morning. And then you smoke 100 cigarettes or more. That devil rain continues pounding on your window. And the tropic winds keep howling at your door. Regardless of all the rain and mud, the feel of the place gets in your blood. But deep in the night there comes unawares the terrible thought that nobody cares. You're back with the blues again. To be even more specific, you've got what they call the blue Pacific blues.
That was Rita Hayworth singing the Blue Pacific Blues. And you've made a television documentary about the Far East since,
haven't
you?
I did. We did two travel shows. We did Paul O'Grady's Orient and Paul O'Grady's America. And we went back to my old apartment in Manila. Howled like a wolf. Howled like a wolf.
It's where your heart is.
Yeah. I get off the plane and I think, I'm home. Mm. I'm home. I just relax. I totally unwind. I love the place.
But when you were whatever age, I mean, your late teens, wasn't it? Early 20s, you did sort of 6 months, your sort of six-month gap year
you did in
Manila. Okay. And then you came back and started working in London as a social worker in Camden. Now, what kind of work did you
do? What I actually was, it wasn't a so I was a peripatetic care officer, which is a fancy title for basically a skivvy. Say a mum went into hospital and there were five children. Rather than split the kids up and put them into various homes and stuff, I'd go in and look after them, as keep them as a family unit. God knows why, because most of them are sort of the Antichrist version of the Waltons. You know, you go and you think, oh, please.
There is a bit of an irony in the fact that you became a bit of a mum, because in fact you were already a dad by then and
this
had sort of deserted, if you like, your illegitimate daughter.
I was 16 when she was conceived, and I was 17 when she was born. And it was at the time my father had died. My mother was giving me a really bad time because she sort of blamed me for my dad's death. But she needed somebody to blame. And she was so upset and confused. And I thought, I've got to get away. I seriously didn't want a child. I'd already said this to my daughter's mum. You know, look, she was a lot older than me as well. I said, I don't want to be a dad. I'm no money. I can't. And what we did was we went to court. I said, I'll provide financially. We went to court and I was ordered to pay £3 a week, which sounds nothing now. But when you earn £6 a week, that's a hell of a lot of money. So I thought I'll go to London and try and earn some money. Mm. You know, that's what happened.
Mm. And but do you still see your daughter?
Love the bones of her. It's a real happy ending story. We got used to each other. And it's true, what's in the dog comes out in the pup, because I'll have a go at her and she'll have a go back at me and I can't answer her back, I can't top her.
And is she proud of you?
She is, yeah, she is.
Difficult, actually, for a child to have a father who dresses up as a woman.
How do you explain to your daughter your dad's Lily Savage? You know, I mean, how do you do it? But she adapted, she's unfazable, my daughter, and I'm really proud to say now that, yes, I do, I love her dearly.
But of course, all of that is quite confusing, because we also read that you've said that you were gay from the day you were born.
God, I was, what's the word I'm looking for? I don't want to say promiscuous as a teenager. Mr. Rattle slag, doesn't he?
Had a large sexual appetite.
I was precocious, precocious, which coming from an Irish Catholic background, you find strange, but no hang-ups at all.
But were you gay or bisexual or what?
Whatever took me fancy at the time. I was experimenting. I was, you know, I wasn't sexually confused because there was no confusion about it. You know, I saw girls I really fancied. I saw fellas I fancied.
So at what point did you decide you were gay and only
women
fancied men?
You're too much asshole, women. I'm sorry, you're far too much asshole. Men are a lot less asshole. So I thought, I'll ship onto the lavender bus, leave the women alone.
What makes them think they have the right to say what God considers vice? What makes them think they have the right to keep us out of paradise? They make our lives hell here on earth, poisoning us with guilt and shame. If we resist, prison awaits, so our love does not speak its name. The crime is when love must hide. From now on we'll love with pride. We're not afraid to be queer and different. If that means hell, well, hell, we'll take the chance. They are so straight, uptight, upright and rigid. They march in lockstep, we prefer to dance. We see a world of romance and of pleasure. All they can see is sheer banality. Lavender nights, our greatest treasure, where we can be just who we want to be. Round us all up, send us away. That's what you'd really like to do. But we're too strong, proud, unafraid. In fact, we almost pity you. You act from fear, why should that be? What is it that you're frightened of? The way that we dress, the way that we meet, the fact that you cannot destroy our love. We're going to win our rights to lavender days and nights. We're not afraid to be queer and different. If that means hell, well, hell, we'll take the chance. They're all so straight, uptight, upright and rigid. They march in lockstep, we prefer to dance. We see a world of romance and of pleasure. All they can see is sheer banality. Lavender nights, our greatest treasure, where we can be just who we want to be. Lavender nights, our greatest treasure, where we can be just who we want to be.
Tell me about your next record, what is it?
My next record is Massenet's Thais, which is of course the story of the Abyssinian hooker who found God. It's got no real meaning for me. It's just a piece of music that I've always loved. It's always been there. And ever it came on the radio, my mother used to do this dreadful tuneless whistle. So she'd go over it in the kitchen. So we'd have, a huge fight when it came on. Now I listen to it in the country, you know, if it comes on, I'll sit down. And whenever, it's like a hymn to me, this piece of music. Whenever it comes on, I always sit down and just reflect and chill out for the 5 minutes or so it takes to play it.
Thank you.
part of Massenet's Meditation from Thais, played by Philippe Graffin with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Yehudi Menuhin. Sir Yehudi Menuhin he was by then. So let's cut, Paul O'Grady, to 1985 and the Vauxhall Tavern in London, where you're behind the bar. What makes you suddenly think you can get up on the stage
well,
and do
I
whatever else is doing?
I was working for Camden. We used to get a lot of time off in Lowe. They didn't pay us overtime, so we got all this time off in Lowe. So I'd do various odds and sods. I'd be a cleaner or a barman or whatever came along. And I was waiting behind the bar in the Elephant and Castle, and they used to have an amateur night on a Tuesday called Ladies' Night, where they had a live comp, and all these, you've never seen acts like them. These acts used to get up and do all these various numbers, mime to records, and I said, well, I could do that. I could compare a show like that.
Oh, compare it. Compare. Not do it.
No,
see.
Compare it.
Okay.
They said, well, go on then, up you get and do it. So the following week I did. Lily was born.
So you compared it as Lily?
I did it as Lily, yeah.
And what made you think to put on? I mean, did you put the full wig on immediately?
Wild Horses wouldn't have got me up as myself. Just no way. I'd have felt far too vulnerable.
I see. So it's the classic thing, you're hiding behind the
It's a nice
disguise.
Suit of armour.
Yeah.
And also, I didn't want to go down the road of sequins and feathers and Shirley Bassey and all that. I thought, I quite like this. I had this image of this hard-bitten hooker, you know, from Birkenhead, who was with her roots showing and her ripping her tights and you know, a bit of a ratty leper skin and the big handbag.
It's the tattoos and the love bites.
This is it, and the love bites and all that business. And, you know, our two children born out of wedlock.
But you never gone the whole hog, as I understand. You never shaved the legs.
Oh, nothing.
You never shaved
nothing.
I mean,
no.
When you take her off, you take her off.
That's
and,
it.
And you're
yeah,
male
yeah,
again.
Yeah, yeah. Don't go in for
that's
any
important.
Of that.
That's sort of very important to you.
Well,
it?
You see, people go on about transvestism. Now, transvestism, to me, is somebody who stands in their bedroom in Marks and Spencer's lingerie, looking at themselves in a mirror, being sexually aroused. I can say I hate dressing up because, one, it's so uncomfortable. I just don't like it at all. I don't get repulsed by it when I look in the mirror. It doesn't freak me out, but it does nothing for me that way. It's a costume.
And so what do you call yourself?
I call myself a drag queen. Somebody says to me, what are you? So I'm a good old-fashioned drag queen, proud of it.
I'm the girl with a little bit extra. I'm the girl with a little bit more. I've got a little bit here, a little bit there, and a very special little bit, but I'm not saying where. The boys think I'm a mystery with very naughty eyes. I never tell them all the truth, but I don't tell them lies. And if they try to find out, well, they'll get a big surprise. I'm the girl with a little bit extra. I'm the girl with a little bit extra. I'm the girl with a little bit more. I've got big red lips, I've got big blue eyes, and a bit that's fond of popping up and shouting out surprise. If something's fun, it can't be wrong, it really must be right. For life is for the living, and tonight I fly my kite. And just before you ask me, I'm not showing you tonight. I'm the girl with a little bit extra. Yes, I'm the girl with a little bit more.
Record number five is, well, one of the greatest singers, Nina Simone, singing one of my favourite songs, I'll Put a Spell on You. And she genuinely sounds like she would. She sounds like a sorceress going around her dungeon, throwing herbs in a pot.
I put a spell on you. You're mine. You better stop the things you do. I ain't lying. No, I ain't lying. You know I can't stand it. You're running around. You know better, Daddy. I can't stand it 'cause you put me down. Yeah, yeah. I put a spell on you. Because you're
Nina Simone and I put a spell on you. So Lily, you know, went from the pubs and clubs. I mean, she became hugely famous and popular. I mean, West End, Prisoner Cell Block H, the musical. You did Annie, or she did Annie.
Annie, Miss
Panto,
Hannigan, yeah.
All the rest of it. But now she's sort of slipping away because you, Paul O'Grady, did Chitty Chitty Bang Bang,
that's
Child
right.
Catcher. You're going to front the Jen game, not her.
Yeah.
Or you're doing the sitcom, yeah. Eyes Down. I mean, yeah. She, are you kind of... Well, shelving her?
She's resting, should we say, Lily. It's just nice because other things have come along. And also, I don't have to dress up. Well, I used to say this until I went into Chitty Bang Bang. I thought, oh, great, I don't have to dress up. I was 1.5 hours putting the Child Catcher's makeup on. And then I'd be on stage for 8 minutes. I thought, I can never get away from dressing up, ever. So, and I'm of the opinion that if you go... I don't like to go on a stage in a T-shirt and jeans. That, to me, is not... not showbiz. I like to see, I like a bit of zhuzh. And Lily was always zhuzhed up to the nines, you know? Mm. She was always there.
Good old fashioned performance.
Exactly. You know, big effort. Showgirls, tiller girls, the lot. And there's Lily in the middle. I'd never completely give her up. And I always said I'd give her up when the public didn't want her anymore, you see. And now people are saying to me, we've had enough of you. When's Lily coming back? So it looks like she's about to rear her ugly head again. I don't know what to do. I'm totally confused career-wise.
Number six
is Elvis Presley, the king himself. Love him. This is my party piece, actually. This is what I get up and do when I've had a few scoops. I've sung this all over the world. Every show I've done, Prisoner Cell Block H, I did it. I do it in the pants.
So it's Lily who sings this, not you, is it?
It's Lily who sings Trouble, yeah.
Yeah.
No, but I'll get up as myself if we're at a party. I was in the Café de Paris recently. They were having an Elvis night. And they said, will you get up? They hadn't even got to the word up. I was on stage with the mic belting this song out.
If you're looking for trouble, you came to the right place. If you're looking for trouble, just look right in my face. I was born standing up and talking back. My daddy was a green-eyed mountain jack because I'm evil. My middle name is Hillary. Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm evil, so don't you mess around with me. Never looked for trouble, but I never ran. I don't take no orders, no kind of man. I'm only made out of flesh, blood, and bone. But if you're gonna start a rumble, don't you try at all alone, because I'm evil. You mess around with me.
Elvis Presley and Trouble. We talked about killing Lily off. You nearly killed yourself off last year, didn't you?
I did, yeah.
47
not intentionally,
years old.
Was it?
Heart attack.
Heart attack, yeah.
Why do you have a heart attack at 47?
Well, my mum and dad both died of heart disease. My grandparents died of heart disease. My sister's had a heart attack. My brother's had a heart attack. So it's in the family.
So did you spot it coming?
No, I had no warning at all.
How did it happen?
I'd been out to a charity dinner, came home. Said if I don't feel too well, and instantly bang on the floor. It just happens like that. You know, I didn't get any pains in the arms or any warnings like that. It just
but apparently you sent for your manager.
I did.
And you did your deathbed speech.
I did. Full Lana Turner deathbed speech. Play the meditation, Thais. I ain't popping my clogs until the meditation's played.
Did you still have a sense of humour?
I did.
Serious?
I did.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. I wasn't scared. I thought I was quite relaxed. There was no white light. There was no angel going, oh, none of that nonsense. So I just lay there and I thought, I don't think I'm going to pull out of this because I felt so wretched. I've never felt anything like it before in my life. Hmm. And hope I never feel anything like it again.
But now what? Your clubbing days are over? Are you taking
No, I'll go to clubs, but I'm not the last to leave. In fact, I went to a club the other night. I was only in there 10 minutes. The size of a 50-year-old man in Lycra dancing to Kylie Minogue had me rushing for the doors.
And you've given up smoking and failed.
Well, this is an ongoing battle with the demon weed. I used to smoke 60 strong cigarettes a day. Now a pack of 20 will last me over a week. Hmm. Seriously. And that's not me saying, I mean, I have the odd one, but I do. Some days I don't have any.
But you work as hard as ever. I mean, the work schedule, obviously.
Well, in showbiz, you've got no choice. And, you know, people say, I thought you were going to take it easy. Fine, then get out of television and theatre, because there's no such thing as taking it easy.
You're either in demand or you're not.
Oh, you're not. That's it.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's go and find a nice little job or something in the Citizens Advice Bureau if you want to take it easy. But you can't, because it's early starts. It's all about money these days. Let's cram everything in. Let's do a 16-hour day. So now I'm doing more, in fact, than I used to do.
And it's all about money because you don't like debt, I understand.
Very bad of debt.
Have you got a mortgage?
No.
Have you got a credit card?
No.
You don't do it?
No, don't
you
do
it. You earn the money and you
never had an overdraft. Never.
Really?
No.
Why is that so important to you?
I think the wolf's never far from the door with me. And because we knew what poverty was when I was a kid, it's always there, you know, and I've got great respect for money. But I mean, tax and VAT is always sorted because it's not my money. That's how I look at it. You know, I think it could end tomorrow. And I'm not one of these people who'd say, oh, well, I've had a great time. I'll go back to my council flat. I'd be livid. I'd hate everybody. I'd be eaten up with bitterness. And believe you me, once you've been used to the high life, you can't go back. So I take care of myself and look to the future.
Incredible. It's impossible, but it's true. A man can talk to the animals. It's a miracle. In a year from now, I guarantee, I'll be the marvel of the mammals, playing chess with camels, no more just a boring old MD. I'll study every living creature's language, so I can speak to all of them on sight. If friends say, can he talk in crab or pelican? You'll say like helica, and you'll be right. And if you just stop to think a bit, there's no doubt of it, I shall win a place in history. For I can walk with the animals, talk with the animals, grunt and squeak and squawk with the animals. And they can squeak and squawk and speak and talk to me!
More music.
The only one for me. I was lying in hospital when I was 11, having my appendix out, and I heard this woman's voice. And I'm not exaggerating when I say I love her. I do love her. I think she's a great star. I think she's a fabulous actress. I always call her Barb. I never call her Streisand. Let's have a bit of Barb. And it reminds me of the spring. You know, when you're wanting things to grow after the winter, you think, you know, come on, bulbs, grow. Come on, please. Let you know, flowers bud and everything. And this is the song for me. I love it.
Hey, buds below, up is where to grow, up with which below can't compare with. Hurry, it's lovely up here. Life down a hole takes an awful toll. What with not a soul there to share with? Hurry, it's lovely up here. Wake up, bestir yourself. It's time that you disinter yourself. You've got a spot to fill, a pot to fill. What a gift package of shower, sun and love. You'll be met above everywhere with fondled and sniffed by millions who drift by. Life here is rosy if you're a posy.
RSVP.
peonies pollinate the breeze, make the queen of bees hot as brandy. Come give at least a preview of Easter. Come have and see the hoodwink. Come up and see the grounds for living.
Barbara Streisand singing Hurry, It's Lovely Up Here, all about making the flowers grow, which is what you now do, Paul O'Grady, in your house in the country. Yes?
Shame to say. I went from nightclubs with the Rolling Stones till all hours of the morning to dealing with cattle.
Apparently Mick Jagger banned you from the Rolling Stones.
He did. You were a bad influence. He did. He said I was a bad influence on Ronnie Wood. Now, I'm sorry, that you think that I've got to put the brakes on now. You know, I'm turning to Janis Joplin here. So I thought, I've got to stop.
But you live there with lots of animals, ridiculous number of animals.
Ridiculous number
cows
of animals.
Cows constantly in labour,
yeah,
and
pigs,
whatever it is, and
goats,
pigs, and Buster
geese,
the dog.
Buster, I've got two dogs, Louie and Buster.
Both Shih Tzus.
Yeah.
But no partner, you're a solitary soul in many
ways. I am actually, yeah. I don't hunt with the pack. You know, I've done that. I've had relationships. They don't work for me. One thing is, I'm very selfish. I don't like sharing a bed. Like the old American movies where they have single beds. I'd have to have separate rooms, separate countries. I do not, because I might want to get up in the middle of the night and paint or read or watch TV or just mooch.
But is it something more than that? Is it that, you know, I don't know, as I talked to you, you know, you're marvellous to talk to and everything, but there's something actually essentially quite private about you, despite all the stories you tell, isn't
there? Yeah, there is. I do like privacy, yeah. I've got to be honest. Yeah, I do. I really do. I like to be a private person. So, I, I don't want to share my life. I know that probably sounds... I've got lots and lots of good friends. I've got lots of what I call back burner. So if you... You know what I mean? Like, if you want a little... I've got intimate friends and I've got good friends. And that suits me fine. I don't actually want a relationship. I don't want to say... Mine is yours and yours is mine.
So a desert island's going to suit you fine in many ways.
Actually, it wouldn't, no.
No?
No, I'd hate it. Oh. Yeah, I'd get extremely...
It's lovely in private.
Yeah, but I'd be bored. You know, you think, what am I going to do? You know, there's no... What do you do on a desert island? And I'm going to get off.
Are you? How are you going to get off?
Well, I don't know, but I'll find a way. I'll get off. Believe you, mate, I will get off. Oh, yes. I'm like a pit bull. Once I get my teeth into something, I'm not letting go until I've either conquered it or I've achieved it. And I think where I was lazy in the past, you know, I've learned computer skills at my time of life. I've learned to drive. I'm having flying lessons. I learned to swim. I'm learning all these things I should have learned years ago. I didn't, because I was either too busy working or I was too lazy or couldn't be bothered, you know. But now I can. Now I've got time and I'm finding time to do these things.
Places I gotta play, all the things that I gotta be yet. Come on, Papa, what do you say? Some people can be content playing bingo and paying rent. That's peachy for some people, for some humdrum people to be. Wonderful dream, Papa. All about June and the Orpheum Circuit. Give me a chance and I know I can work it. I had a dream, just as real as can be, Papa. There I was in Mr. Orpheum's office, and he was saying to me, Rose, get yourself some new orchestrations, new routines and red velvet curtains. Get a feathered hat for the baby, photographs in front of a theater. Get an agent and in jig time you'll be being booked in the big time. Oh, what a dream, a wonderful dream, Papa. And all that I need is 88 bucks, Papa. That's what he said, Papa. Only 88 bucks.
You ain't getting 88 cents from me, Rose.
Well, I'll get it someplace else. But I'll get it and get my kids out! Goodbye to blueberry pie. Good riddance to all the socials I had to go to, all the lodges I had to play, all the Shriners I said hello to. Hey, LA, I'm coming your way. Some people sit on their butts. Got the dream, yeah, but not the guts. That's living for some people, for some humdrum people, I suppose. Well, they can stay and rot.
The last record is Carlos Gardel with one of the great tangos, La Compresita.
Si supiera que aún dentro de mi alma conservo aquel cariño que tuve para ti. Quién sabe si supieras que nunca te he olvidado. Volviendo a tu pasado, te acordarás de mí.
los amigos ya no vienen ni siquiera visitarme. Nadie quiere consolarme en mi aflicción. Desde el día que te fuiste, siento angustias en mi pecho. Decime, canta, ¿qué has hecho de mi pobre corazón? Al cotorro abandonado, ya ni el sol de la mañana asoma por la ventana como cuando estabas vos. Y aquel perrito compañero que por tu ausencia no comía, al verme solo el otro día también me dejó. Si supiera que aún dentro de mi alma conservo aquel cariño que tuve para ti, quién sabe si supiera que nunca te he olvidado. Volviendo a tu pasado, te acordarás de mí.
Carlos Gardel and La Comparsita.
La Comparsita. I've adored the time. I used to go to a dance school in Liverpool called Vernon Johnson with my friend Angela Walsh, who's the actress, and we learned to tango. My God, were we slick, me and Angela, when we tangoed. And I think the tango is the only dance two men should ever do, because it's about two people vying for the position of top dog. Two men should be like that.
They do in Spain, don't they? Heterosexual men.
Oh, you get two heterosexual men doing this tango. So erotic. I love that tango beat and the passion and the smouldering and the fire. And whoa, God, let's have a tango, Sue. Clear the table.
Now, if you were on your desert island and you could only have one of those, it sounds like it's got to be the tango, I don't know. Well, you can't tango by yourself on the beach, can you?
I think it'd have to be the meditation.
Oh, would it? This is the death music.
Well, I'd die on a desert island, sat there in a lotus. I ate sand, so sat there in sand, being eaten alive by mozzies, blistered by the sun. I've got Irish skin, I'm not white, I'm blue.
What about your book?
The book would be a book written by John Laird. And it'd be called Shipbuilding for Beginners to get me off.
This is a cheat. No, you're not allowed a practical book.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, not if you're going to build a ship. You can read about building a ship.
But I wouldn't be allowed to build a ship. No. Okay, then. Then I'll tell you what book I'd take. It's a book from my childhood. It's The Borrowers by Mary Norton, which I was first given when I was 5 by my auntie. And just fell in love with it. And still read it now. Read it about once a month.
About your luxury.
My luxury item would be, it's by Avon, it's called Skin So Soft, and it's the most effective mosquito spray I have ever used. I've been in jungles in Malaysia, nothing's bitten me because of this stuff, it's wonderful.
What about, let me just ask you finally about your mother.
Did she ever see you?
No.
You kept her secret.
No, she
Lily?
Died before Lily read her ugly
but
head.
But you didn't want her to know about it, did you?
No, because I thought she'd worry. As long as you made a good living, my mother didn't care. But I think show business would have worried her.
Would it?
Yeah, Lily
wouldn't
have bothered
her. She'd been very proud of you, though.
I think she probably would have. Yeah.
Paul O'Grady with Skin So Soft. Thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert
Islanders. You're very well. It's been a pleasure.